students, let's again start a new poem. Chapter 4 we did last time. Okay, this poem is part of that chapter 4. Poem number 4. This is Amanda. We are going to start with. This is written by Robin Klein. A unique poem of its kind. You people, when you will read out this poem, you will feel like something related to your life as well. Okay, let me just tell why you will feel like that. This poem, Amanda, actually Amanda is name of the girl in the poem. Okay, so this poem, in the poem, only her mother's instructions are given. How mother is instructed to her, she's commanding to her, she's scolding her, don't do that, Amanda, don't do that. And you know, she's being scolded. Okay, and then this girl, Amanda, she is now imagining something is going on in her mind and she's thinking. Okay, she wants to revolt against all those commands and instructions mother is giving. This is basically depends on her. Okay, now you may be a number of times you people also have faced the parents are scolding you, parents when they scold you, when they ask you, don't do that, don't stand here, don't sit like that, sit properly, don't use mobile for a long time. How do you feel at that moment? Naturally, this is a child history. Okay, how do they feel? They want to revolt against those instructions. Because why this happens? Because they want freedom. This is a child's nature. They want freedom and they want to freely move anywhere. They want to do anything free. So this is the theme of this poem, Amanda. Okay, before we begin with this poem, let me explain this poem is written in a different way. How different? You will find that three lines here, after every three, four lines, these are instructions of mother. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. These are instructions of mother. Okay? And here after these instructions, you will find these three more lines, bracketed words. If you can see, these are in bracket. Okay? Now, these are not the mother's words. This is the imagination of the girl child. How she is thinking. At that time when mother is instructing her, how she is, what are the feelings that are occurring in her mind and how she is feeling like that. This is her imagination. She wants to revolt. How she wants to go, there is a language, Emerald Sea, where the soul in inhabitant is living, a mermaid drifting this way. So when mother is saying, stop doing that, Amanda, what she is thinking, she wants to go anywhere, she wants to go from here and wants to move freely like a mermaid, where there is no one, she is alone in the sea and enjoying it. So she is thinking. This poem is all based on that mother's instructions and what is the feeling of the child at that time. Okay, I will explain you line wise, paragraph wise. We will start with the poem. Explanation of the poem.
Okay, let's start with the poem now. This is written by Robin Klein. Robin Klein, she is an Australian poetess. And she has mostly written about the children, literature about children. Okay, let's start about poem. And before you do the question answers in your notebook, you have to write one activity also. What is that? As you see that every child feels like they're controlled and instructed by the parents all the time. So all the time for doing one thing and another thing, we always feel like that. You always feel like that. So you people also will be having same feelings, that your freedom is curtailed by your parents. So what you have to do is you have to write down some things which parents asked you not to do, and then what did you do about that. Okay, so make a list of that and then do the question answers. Now, explanation of the poem. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. So now we are starting with the poem. Don't bite your nails, Amanda. Don't hunch your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. So mother is instructing the child. She is giving instructions and telling her, the girl child, that don't bite your nails. Don't hunch here. Hunch, if you can see this word, hunch. Hunch refers means bend your shoulders. Baby, mother is asking her to sit in right posture. So mother is asking, don't hunch, don't bend your shoulders, Amanda. Stop that slouching and sit up straight, Amanda. Slouching again is sitting in a wrong posture, sitting with bent shoulders. So mother is again asking her not to bend her shoulders and sit straight, not to bite her nails. So mother is instructing the child. Okay, now mother, when she is instructing, then what the child is doing at the time, is she listening? So now see what she is doing. These bracketed words, as I told you, this is imagination of the girl. So what she is thinking when mother is instructing, point out to her her mistakes, and she is having some thoughts in her mind. What are they? What she is imagining at the moment? There is a language emerald sea, where the sole inhabitant is me, a mermaid drifting blissfully. What the child is having, she is thinking about. She is thinking about something else when mother is scolding. Okay, what she is thinking? There is a language. Language is a relaxed. Emerald refers to green, green sea. So where the sole inhabitant is me. She is imagining that she is not at home, and she is anywhere in the calm place where sea is there, sea water is there, and she is moving there, and just like this mermaid, you know, it's a it's a half body is of a human, like a human, and half is of a fish. So this mermaid is a fictional character. She is imagining herself that she is a mermaid, and she is swimming somewhere in the water. Sole inhabitant in the large green sea. She is the only one who is swimming. No one is there, and she is enjoying her as a mermaid. She is drifting, she is moving, she is swimming very calmly, very blissfully. She is moving, and there is no one to instruct her at that moment. So when mother is scolding her, she is thinking that. Now, did you finish your homework, Amanda? Did you tidy your room, Amanda? I thought I told you, clean your shoes, Amanda. So again, mother is instructing. She is giving instructions again and again. Did you finish your homework, Amanda? So mother is asking about the homework, and then side by side she is asking another question also. Did you clean your room? I thought you clean, and but I thought I told you to clean your shoes, Amanda. Instructions after instructions are being given by the mother. First she is asking about the homework, then she asks, have you cleaned your room? Then she asks, have you cleaned your shoes, Amanda? So now Amanda, who is again frustrated, and she is thinking something else. What she is thinking, side by side, when mother is speaking, her mind is somewhere else. She is imagining something else. So what she is imagining? I am an orphan. Orphan is a child without parent. So see the condition of this girl child. She is feeling like that it's better I don't have parent, and I'm an orphan. And then I'm roaming the street. Naturally, a childless, parentsless child will not be having any home also. So I'm roaming the street somewhere, a pattern of dust with hushed bare feet, without shoes. I'm moving in the streets, roaming somewhere, and making patterns on the dust with my feet. And I'm enjoying my freedom. The silence is golden. Why? Because mother is speaking continuously. She is instructing, and she feels like silence is golden. I'm in that silent mood where no one is there. I'm an orphan, no parent, no one is in for the instructions. And because freedom is very sweet, what is the reason why she is feeling like? Because she wants the freedom where there is no one to point out at her. So she is asking for that freedom. And she is imagining herself as an orphan and moving freely where no parent is giving any instructions to her. Now, don't eat that chocolate, Amanda. Remember your acne, Amanda. Will you please look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? Now, again, mother's instructions came in that don't eat chocolates. If she start eating chocolates, the mother again is giving instructions. Don't eat. The reason why, she is saying, you will be having pimples, you will be having acne, you will be having pimples on your mouth. So why don't you eat so much, too much chocolates? Mother is scolding her. She is nagging her. Will you please look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? Now, maybe the child doesn't want to look towards the mother. Maybe she is frustrated, or maybe she is having lack of confidence. So her eyes are not towards the mother. Eyes somewhere else, looking somewhere else. Mother is speaking and she is not giving any attention to the mother. So mother is asking her, will you look at me when I'm speaking to you, Amanda? She wants the attention of this girl, that listen to me what I'm saying. So Now, what is the imagination of the girl now? See, what is she imagining? I am Rapunzel. Rapunzel is a fictitious character. It's a character in fairy tales. Okay. There was a girl who was like this long-haired girl who was taken by a witch, who was stolen by a witch, and she was captivated in a tower. Okay, so she lived there lonely life, no one was there to take care of her. So what she is imagining, that she is a Rapunzel, that character of the fairy tales, and she don't have anyone to care about, no one is there with her. Life in a tower, when she is captured in the tower, she is alone, she is imagining that condition. That how happy this girl would have been there, because she life there will be tranquil, very peace, very cool, where no disturbance is there, no one is too disturbed and rare. She is asking that girl may be having so blissful life, very peaceful life, very quiet life, no one will be caring about her, but that also was is a sort of freedom for her. So she is imagining herself Rapunzel. Now, I certainly will never let down my hair. So now if you can see this line, I will certainly, because in story of Rapunzel, what happened in fairy tale, she is having a long hairs. So long hair, when she kept out of the window, so with those hair, a thief came into her tower. So she's saying, I will not do that mistake. I will not let my long hair down the window so that no one come to curtail my freedom. No one is able to come to me to interrupt me in my freedom. So now, stop. Now again, mother is asking her, mother is instructing her, and she is not giving any response. So mother is angry over that. Stop that sulking at once, Amanda. Sulking is bad mood, feeling bad. You're always so moody, Amanda. Anyone would think that I nagged at you, Amanda. Nagged at you is harassing someone or to find fault in others. So now mother is asking her, why are you feeling so sad? Why are you sitting so sad? At once she's talking now, when she saw that the girl is not responding to her. So she started talking with this girl and asking that, why are you sitting so sad? You are always so moody. You are always moody girl. When you are happy, when you are sad, I don't know why you sit like that. Anyone would think that, people will think, what they will think, that I nagged you, I harass you, I always find faults in you, Amanda. Don't do that. Sit properly and just listen to me and react to those. Reaction should be there, and you should listen and follow my instructions. Don't feel so bad, so sad. Don't show that sadness on your face. So mother here is talking to her. Okay, if you feel why this girl now this girl, because here if we talk about the mother, mother is very dominating. She is a dominating sort of lady, and she is not showing any real code of conduct. Okay, so she is not showing any real code of conduct, and she is feeling lonely. Okay, she is feeling lack of confidence also, because where we have read in the poem that she was biting the nails and she was not looking into the eye of the mother. So that shows lack of confidence of the girl. She was lost personality and lack of confidence. Mother as well, she was dominating, and she was not understanding the child. Okay, so now again, this was the poem. Okay, after this we do the poetic devices of this poem. Okay, let's do para wise all the poetic devices. I will explain you. You can note down in your notebooks also. So first paragraph, first we talk about poetic devices. Okay, poetic devices, as I told you, how do we see the poetic device, rhyme scheme, first of all we'll discuss. Okay, rhyme scheme, as I told you, you have to check the last words of the poem, the last words of the every line, you have to check for the rhyme scheme. So here if you can see, this last words, the pronunciation, the phonetics you have to change. Amanda, Amanda, repetition, straight is not matching with so we are giving it another letter B. Amanda is matching with A. Okay, and then see me, these imaginary words also will take in rhyme scheme as a paragraph. Okay, so here see me blissfully, see me blissfully here. So now this is C, C, and C, because all are matching with each other. So this is the rhyme scheme A. BACCC. So the first poetic device here used is metaphor. Metaphor is a direct comparison without using any like or as. When one thing, when object is having the similar qualities like another object. Okay, you can see there is a language, emerald sea. Emerald is a lush green color. Okay, so sea water is being compared with the lush green color. Emerald, like emerald, sea water looked like emerald. Okay, so this is metaphor. Metaphor being used here. Okay. Device metaphor. And now another poetic device here is anaphora. Anaphora, if you can see the first anaphora, I told you in the previous poems also. Anaphora. What was anaphora? If you remember, I told you that when first two lines, two consecutive lines are starting with the same phonetic words. Don't bite, don't hunch. Okay, don't bite, don't hunch. When two lines, don't be confused with anaphora and alliteration and repetition. Repetition and anaphora both are separate things. Amanda, that is repetition here. So don't be confused with this. Anaphora is when two consecutive lines are beginning with the same phonetic sound. Don't bind, don't hunch. Okay, so this is anaphora. This is in the next slide also, if you can see. Did you finish? Did you tidy your room? Did word again in two consecutive lines it is used here. So this is again anaphora. So after anaphora, it is clear. Is that clear to you? Anaphora is repetition of the words at the beginning, two consecutive lines when starting with the same phonetic words. That is repetition. Anaphora. Okay. Now we talk about another poetic device. Let me tell you about another one. Next poetic device here is repetition. Okay, repetition. Amanda is repeated a number of times in the poem. That is repetition. Okay, so this is again repetition is being used in the poem. Okay, so now next, let us see. Next is alliteration. We see the examples of alliteration now. Alliteration. I told you what was alliteration. If you remember, alliteration is repetition. It is also a repetition of phonetics words. But alliteration, you can see here, when two words or more words in one line, they are having the beginning sound same beginning sound is there, that is called repetition. Alliteration. If you can see, stop sulking, SS sound is repeated. Okay, when S sound is repeated in two words or maybe a number of more words are there, so this is called alliteration. So this is another one being used here. Okay, so these are the poetic devices used here. Thank you for watching the poem. I hope you understood it well.